We see a growing interest among young people in seeking knowledge. And we see an ever-increasing engagement in tackling major global challenges. This is where the Nobel Prize has an important task: to serve as a source of inspiration for people who want to build a better world. This is the truly amazing legacy left by Alfred Nobel 120 years after his death. Your Majesties, Your Royal Highnesses, esteemed Nobel laureates, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening, and once again, most welcome to this year's Nobel Prize Award ceremony.
Eders majestäter, Ders kungliga högheter, ärade Nobelpristagare, kära kollegor i det internationella vetenskapssamhället, mina damer och herrar. Fysik är en mänsklig aktivitet och bedrivs som all sådan
in evolves in the context of historical, geographic and linguistic settings. Nonetheless, the central results of physics, natural laws, transcend these barriers. They are the same today as they were at inception, and they will also be valid in the future. They are the same here on Earth as on the exotic planets that we now know are orbiting distant stars. The laws of physics are universal, and they are formulated in the language of mathematics. This extraordinary universality is closely connected to the fundamental properties of space-time and matter, which are reflected in the form of symmetries in the laws of physics. A branch of mathematics used to describe symmetries is called group theory and was substantially developed during the 19th century. Only later did this mathematics turn out to be an indispensable tool in the new quantum theory that revolutionized physics during the 20th century. The role of group theory in quantum mechanics is but one example of how major scientific breakthroughs often require new language. And since the language of physics is mathematical, breakthroughs in physics often require new mathematics. Newton developed the theory of derivatives and integrals at the same time as his mechanics. And Einstein formulated his general theory of relativity in terms of the then contemporary mathematics of curved spaces, which was unfamiliar to physicists. Mathematical language is abstract, but it has two major virtues. A mathematically formulated theory is quantitative and can therefore often be used to, in detail and with high precision, explain and predict the results of experiments. Mathematics is deductive, so mathematical arguments can be used to predict the results of future experiments. The discovery of the Higgs particle is a striking example. Deduction is indeed an important tool in all the sciences, but it excels in theoretical physics. Many philosophers, physicists, and mathematicians have marveled at the astonishing ability of mathematics to describe nature. In a famous essay, Eugene Wigner called this the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics. This year's Nobel Prize in Physics rewards contributions to theoretical physics that are examples of precisely this unreasonable effectiveness. By using new concepts taken from the branch of mathematics called topology, the 2016 laureates did two things. First, they explained striking observations, and second, they made theoretical discoveries, that is, they predicted new phenomena that were observed later. Topology describes the robust properties of objects. Topologically, an egg and a football belong to the same category, the category of three-dimensional objects without holes. But a donut, along with a wedding ring, belongs to the category of objects with one hole. The number of holes, which is always an integer, is an example of a topological invariant. Quantum mechanics was born as a theory of microscopic objects, individual atoms and molecules, but it also soon came to be used in order to understand the usual phases of matter, gases, liquids and solids. Superfluids and superconductors were also added to these. Here too, symmetry concepts proved extremely important. By studying symmetry properties, Lev Landau was able to classify possible phases of matter and describe the mechanisms of the transitions between them. This year's laureates showed that Landau's classification of the phases of matter was incomplete. There are additional so-called topological phases with characteristic values for different topological invariants. With the aid of topology, they also showed how one can explain observed transitions between different phases of matter that should not be possible according to earlier theory. It often takes time before new concepts and new ways of thinking have an impact. But during the past decade, research in the topological phases of matter has virtually exploded. Today's young physicists work with topological concepts as self-confidently and skillfully as earlier generations have done with derivatives, symmetries, and geometry. Not only have this year's laureates made important special discoveries, but in addition, and perhaps most importantly, they have set the stage for a new way of describing matter. They have given us a rich mathematical language with deep and beautiful abstract concepts. But in the natural sciences, beauty is not enough. Mathematics is full of beautiful results. Truth is also necessary. This requires experiments and measurements. The theory of topological matter has passed this test with distinction. It combines truth with beauty. This is theoretical physics at its best.
You have been awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics for, I quote the citation, theoretical discoveries of topological phase transition and topological phases of matter. On behalf of the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, it's my honor and my pleasure to convey to you the warmest congratulations. I now ask you to step forward to receive your Nobel Prizes from the hands of His Majesty the King.
Eders majestäter, eders kungliga högheter, ärade pristagare, mina damer och herrar. Den mänskliga utvecklingen är starkt förknippad med maskiner. Dessa har hjälpt oss att klara av uppgifter som faller utanför vår egen förmåga och på många sätt lett till högre livskvalitet. Under årtusenden har vårt samhälle åtnjutit en ständigt ökande mängd användbara maskiner.
Plethora of useful machines for various purposes, in many ways leading to an enhanced quality of our lives. This progress has in particular accelerated since the Industrial Revolution, with its key discoveries resulting in a giant leap forward and dramatically changing the world. Today, we are at the dawn of a new revolution that will bring us yet another giant leap forward. Humankind has always striven to push the limits of machine function and construction. For example, regarding how small they can be made. The ultimate limit of this endeavor is to make molecular-sized machine structures that are less than a thousandth of the width of a human hair. This fundamental challenge has been met by this year's laureates, who have successfully demonstrated that the rational design and synthesis of molecular machines are indeed possible. A groundbreaking step in this development was taken in the early 1980s, when Jean-Pierre Sauvage and his group discovered an efficient way to make molecules that are attached to each other using mechanical bonds. The group that thus managed to link two molecular rings together in a so-called catenane, where the rings could move freely relative each without being separated. This marked a breakthrough towards molecular machinery, and Sauvage was able to show how such structures can undergo controlled motion. By the turn of the 1990s, Fraser Stoddart, as we see here, and his group made other important advances towards molecular machinery. For example, the group used another type of mechanical bond and developed so-called rotaxanes, in which a ring-shaped molecule was tied to move between set positions along an axle. Both Stoddart and Sauvage were also able to show how the movement in these structures could be controlled from external input, and subsequently developed a wide range of machine-like structures, such as molecular muscles, actuators, elevators, memories, motors, and pumps. The motor components are of central importance in machines able to drive other parts of the construction. By the late 1990s, Ben Feringer and his group made a significant breakthrough when they demonstrated a molecular rotary motor. The construction was driven by light and heat and was based on isomerizable bonds and molecular asymmetry, where the motor parts could rotate unidirectionally relative to each other. The group was later able to improve the design to create motors that can rotate in either direction at very high speeds, and showed how the components can affect the rotation of much larger objects. In a more playful example, Feringer's group also constructed a four-wheel drive nanocar that can move over a surface. Through the design and synthesis of very challenging structures, combined with the understanding and development of controlled motion and function, Sauvage, Stoddart, and Feringer have created functional molecular machines. Their work has formed the basis for an entirely new field of research for which the three laureates have been groundbreaking pioneers and sources of inspiration.
Academy of Sciences, I wish to convey to you our warmest congratulations. May I now ask you to step forward and receive your Nobel Prizes from the hands of His Majesty the King.
Eders majestäter, eders kungliga högheter, ärade pristagare, mina damer och herrar. Vi har idag samlats för utdelningen av årets Nobelpris i Konserthuset, ett av Sveriges arkitektoniska mästerverk.
Created in 1926. The concert hall is in good shape despite intensive use over many decades, thanks to repairs and maintenance. Today it is also newly cleaned and spotless. The consumables that previous guests have left behind have been collected and hopefully recycled. We view this daily maintenance as something self-evident. But if the concert hall had not been repaired or cleaned in 90 years, this would of course have been obvious to us. Similarly, our body's cells are constantly replacing defective components and removing waste materials. This year's Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine is about how the cell maintains its interior and recycles its own components in order to function optimally and adapt to new circumstances. The cell's degradation station, the lysosome, was identified by biochemical methods as early as 1955 by the Belgian scientist Christian de Duve. For this discovery, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 1974. Shortly after the discovery of the lysosome, several researchers using electron microscopy showed that lysosomes seemed to exist in all organisms having nucleated cells. They also observed that lysosomes could sometimes be full of normal cellular components in various stages of decomposition. Remarkably, it appeared as if the cell could break down some of its own contents. In 1963, Christian de Duve named this process autophagy, which means self-eating. In the following decades, some progress was made in our understanding of autophagy, but fundamental questions remained unanswered. Is autophagy crucial to normal cell function? If so, how is autophagy regulated? Is autophagy important in human disease? When Yoshinori Osumi, that we see here, was in his early 40s, he was eager to make new major scientific advances. In the late 1980s, he therefore decided to take on a whole new area of research, cell degradation processes. Osumi predicted that degradation might very well be a process just as important as the production of new components in a cell. For his studies, he chose to use ordinary baker's yeast. Yeast cells are unicellular eukaryotes, nucleated organism that can be used as model systems for understanding fundamental processes also found in human cells. By employing a brilliant experimental strategy, Osumi was able to show that autophagy actually does occur in yeast. He then carried out a series of very elegant studies that enabled him to identify a number of genes that are vital in regulating autophagy. Osumi went on to show new, completely unexpected biochemical mechanisms that are controlled by these genes. It also soon turned out that the cellular machinery that controls autophagy is highly conserved and is found in all organisms containing nucleated cells. The discovery of the molecular machinery of autophagy revolutionized Osumi's entire field of research. And we know today that autophagy is a very important maintenance process that ensures the normal functioning of our cells. For example, autophagy plays a key role when we adjust our metabolism to fasting and starvation. Impairments in the regulation of autophagy are linked to a variety of human diseases, such as diabetes, cancer, infections, and severe disorders of the nervous system. Thanks to Osumi's fundamental discoveries, We now know that autophagy plays a fundamental role in many different biological processes.
And combat disease. With a series of brilliant experiments, you have opened up a new field in biology. On behalf of the Nobel Assembly at Karolinska Institutet, it is my great privilege to convey to you our warmest congratulations. I now ask you to step forward to receive your Nobel Prize from the hands of His Majesty the King.
Eders majestäter, eders kungliga högheter, ärade Nobelpristagare, mina damer och herrar. Hur sker
in the world of literature? Often it is when someone seizes upon a simple, overlooked form, discounted as art in the higher sense, and makes it mutate. Thus, at one point, emerged the modern novel from anecdote and letter. Thus arose drama in a new age from high jinks on planks placed on barrels in a marketplace. Thus songs in the vernacular dethroned learned Latin poetry. Thus, too, did La Fontaine take animal fables and Hans Christian Andersen fairy tales from the nursery to Parnassian heights. Each time this occurs, our idea of literature changes. In itself, it ought not to be a sensation that a singer-songwriter now stands recipient of the literary Nobel Prize. In a distant past, all poetry was sung or tunefully recited. Poets were rhapsodes, bards, troubadours. Lyrics comes from lyre. But what Bob Dylan did was not to return to the Greeks or the Provençals. Instead, he dedicated himself, body and soul, to 20th century American popular music, the kind played on radio stations and gramophone records for ordinary people, white and black, protest songs, country, blues, early rock, gospel, mainstream music. He listened day and night, testing the stuff on his instruments, trying to learn. But when he started to write similar songs, they came out differently. In his hands, the material changed from what he discovered in heirloom and scrap, in banal rhyme and quick wit, in curses and pious prayers, sweet nothings and crude jokes. He panned poetry gold. Whether on purpose or by accident is irrelevant. All creativity begins in imitation. Even after 50 years of uninterrupted exposure, we are yet to absorb music's equivalent of the fable's Flying Dutchman. He makes good rhymes, said a critic, explaining greatness. And it is true. His rhyming is an alchemical substance that dissolves contexts to create new ones, scarcely containable by the human brain. It was a shock. With a public expecting poppy folk songs, there stood a young man with a guitar, fusing the languages of the street and the Bible into a compound that would have made the end of the world seem a superfluous replay. At the same time, he sang of love with the power of conviction everyone wants to own. All of a sudden, much of the bookish poetry in our world felt anemic. And the routine song lyrics his colleagues continued to write were like old-fashioned gunpowder following the invention of dynamite. Soon, people stopped comparing him to Woody Guthrie and Hank Williams and turned instead to Blake, Rimbaud, Whitman, Shakespeare. In the most unlikely setting of all, the commercial gramophone record, he gave back to the language of poetry its elevated style, lost since the Romantics. Not to sing of eternities, but to speak of what was happening around us. As if the Oracle of Delphi were reading the evening news. Recognizing that revolution by awarding Bob Dylan the Nobel Prize was a decision that seemed daring only beforehand and already seems obvious. But does he get the prize for upsetting the system of literature? No, not really. There is a simpler explanation. One that we share with all those who stand with beating hearts in front of the stage at one of the venues on his never-ending tour, waiting for that magical voice. Chamfort made the observation that when a master such as La Fontaine appears, the hierarchy of genres, the estimation of what is great and small, high and low in literature, is nullified. What matter the rank of a work when its beauty is of the highest rank, he wrote. That is the straight answer to the question of how Bob Dylan belongs in literature. As the beauty of his songs is of the highest rank. By means of his oeuvre, Bob Dylan has changed our idea of what poetry can be and how it can work. He is a singer worthy of a place beside the Greeks, beside Ovid, beside the romantic visionaries, beside the kings and queens of the blues, beside the forgotten masters of brilliant standards. If people in the literary world groan, one must remind that the gods don't write, they dance and they sing. The good wishes of the Swedish Academy follow Mr. Dylan on his way to coming bandstands. Standing ovations for this year's Literature Prize here in the Stockholm Concert Hall. The 1500...
I've stepped in the middle of seven sad forests, been out in front of a dozen dead oceans, been 10,000 miles on the mouth of a graveyard. It's a hard, it's a hard, it's a hard, it's a hard, it's a hard rain. Gonna fall. What did you see, my blue-eyed son? What did you see, my darling young one? Saw a newborn babe with wild wolves all around it. Saw the highway of diamonds with nobody on it. I saw the black branch with blood that kept dripping. I saw the babe that was just bleeding. I saw the babe that... I'm sorry. Earth. Saw 10... I'm sorry. Could we start that section? I apologize. Sorry, I'm so nervous. So a newborn babe with wild wolves all around it. Saw a highway of diamonds with nobody on it. I saw the black branch with blood that kept dripping.
So the room full of men whose hammers were bleeding, I saw the white ladder all covered with water. So 10,000 talkers whose tongues were all broken. I saw guns and sharp swords in the hands of young children. And it's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart rings gonna fall. What did you hear, my blue-eyed son? And what did you hear, my darling young one? Heard the sound of the thunder that roared out a warning. Heard the roar of a wave that could drown the whole world. Heard one person laughing, heard many people laughing. Heard nobody listening. Heard one person starve, heard many people laughing. Heard the song of a poet who died in the gutter. Heard the sound of a clown that cried in the alley. It's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart rings gonna fall. Who did you meet, my blue-eyed son? And who did you meet, my darling young one? I met a young child beside a dead pony. I met a young man and had a black dog. I met a young woman whose body was burning. I met a young girl, she gave me a rainbow. I met a young man, he was wounded in love. I met another man, he was wounded in hatred. It's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart. It's a heart rings gonna fall. And what do you do now, my blue-eyed son? And what do you do now, my darling young one? I'm going back out for the rain starts a-falling. I'm going down deep in the deepest black forest, where the people are many and their hands are all empty, where the pellets of poison have flooded their water. We're home in the valley meets the damp, dirty prison. And the executioner's face is always well hidden. Where hunger is ugly, where souls are forgotten. Where black is the color, where none is the number. And I'll tell it and think it and speak it and breathe it. And reflect from the mountains so all souls can see it. And I'll stand in the ocean until I start sinking. And I'll know my soul well if I start singing. It's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart, it's a heart ring. Gonna fall.
Eders majestäter, Eders kungliga högheter,
ärade pristagare,
mina damer och herrar. På en plats där regnet inte faller kanske lika hårt, nämligen utanför dagens Izmir i Turkiet. Där låg under antiken den grekiska staden Teos. Och under utgrävningarna i stan
of that city, archaeologists discovered a 1.5 meter high white marble stele with a 50-line long chiseled inscription. It turned out to be a 2,200 years old lease agreement for a property including buildings, farmland and associated slaves. A wealthy man in Teos had donated the property to a nearby gymnasium, but the students, who were busy with their studies and sports, leased it out to the highest bidder. One clause in the detailed agreement gave the owners the right to inspect yearly whether the tenant was keeping the buildings in good repair and taking good care of the farmland. More than half of the lines of the inscription listed the extra fees and penalties that could be charged to the tenant in case of a breach of contract. The agreement also gave the owners the right to hold religious ceremonies on the property 3 days per year. This not only provided the students with spiritual sustenance, but also made their rental income tax-free. In other words, even the ancient Greeks had written contracts with each other. In today's society, contracts are even more important. We enter into job contracts with employers and loan contracts with banks, and we buy insurance to protect ourselves against theft and accidents. The most successful of us can write wills, including provisions that are maintained for more than 100 years. Contracts may be long and full of fine print, but they can also be simple and or implied, such as the weekly allowance we promise to give our children if they clean their rooms. Contracts also regulate non-economic relationships at all levels of society, from marriage to constitutional laws to international treaties. Contracts can make us think of unpleasantness in arguments. The tenant in Teos had to accept stringent clauses and threatening sanctions, yet the fundamental aim of contracts is cooperation. A well-written agreement creates a golden compromise between parties with partly divergent interests. Entering into agreements is a difficult art. Poorly designated agreements can lead to deception and unnecessary conflicts. Well-drafted contracts, however, encourage each party to act in a way that benefits everyone. This year's prize in economic sciences is being awarded for theories about writing good contracts. Contracts usually specify payments for certain behaviors or outcomes. Bengt Holmström's work examines both the benefits and drawbacks of such economic rewards. A variable salary can cause us to become more goal-oriented and to work harder. But it can also make us assume excessive risks, focus on the wrong things, and become less enthusiastic about our work. Holmström has also shown how contracts should be adjusted when the parties will be working together over a long period of time, and how good agreements can encourage an individual, even though only team performance can be observed. One common denominator is that contracts must be balanced and adapted to the specific situation. The future is often too complex and unpredictable for a contract to be able to describe all conceivable circumstances. In that case, the contract can regulate who has the right to make decisions in what situations. Oliver Hart's research on incomplete contracts deals with how decision-making rights should be allocated. Among other things, his works provide us with a rich theory of property rights. Perhaps it would have been better for the students in Teos if they had sold their property to the tenant and saved themselves the trouble to carving out 50 lines of ancient Greek text in marble. Hart's toolkit can be used to understand whether two companies should merge, how to design an effective bankruptcy law, and whether to operate a particular welfare service in the private or public sector.
We can better understand many real-world contracts and contractual institutions. But more importantly, your work
helps us write better contracts to enhance cooperation and welfare. So your research is an outstanding example of practically useful theory in the best sense of the term. It's an honor and a privilege to convey to you, on behalf of the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, our warmest congratulations. I now ask you to receive your prizes from His Majesty the King.
Jani.